My name is Howard Jarvis. My purpose is to urge you to concentrate your undivided attention on what Dr. Carroll says on this record. In the next few minutes, you will hear evidence that our priceless individual liberty, now being crushed by our government, will soon be obliterated in America unless we, the people, acting individually, prevent this loss by rapid, united, purposeful political action. Dr. Carroll's historical thesis proves that without individual liberty, there has been no worthwhile human progress, that the historical destroyer of human liberty is tyrannical government, that all civilizations before ours were destroyed by self-created tyranny, that we Americans are rapidly creating a similar tyranny in our own country. You may wonder how history can be new, but Dr. Carroll's historical thesis is very new. Dr. Carroll makes a documented, crystal-clear case that has not been made before. It is a case that will move millions if we make sure that they hear it. Our purpose in presenting this record is to urge you to do more now in the fight for lasting individual liberty. You can help get this record into libraries, schools, clubs, and meetings of all kinds. You might get it on a radio station. The goal is to get this record heard nationwide in every possible community quickly. Time is running out. I give you Dr. Warren Carroll, Ph.D., from Columbia University, historian extraordinary. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Warren H. Carroll. My purpose is to discuss the rise and fall of civilizations, to explain a repeating pattern in history which shows that their rise results from individual freedom, and that the cause of their fall is unlimited and all-powerful government. Just where does our Western civilization stand today in the light of history? Most of us have asked ourselves that question. An awareness of its meaning and importance has sunk deep into our minds, as is shown by the popularity of expressions like the mainstream, the wave of the future, history is against you, and you can't turn back the clock. We are conscious of being caught up in a kind of tidal current which is sweeping us all towards some unknown destination. Whether we swim with that current or against it, we know that it is there. From our personal standpoint in the present, we can only feel the tidal currents of history without fully understanding or visualizing them. Only the longest perspectives of the past and a willingness to use our minds to learn the greatest and most comprehensive lessons the past has to teach us can give us the answers we seek. The search for a pattern in history is not new. Two of the ablest thinkers of the 20th century have attempted it, Oswald Spengler and Arnold Toynbee. Spengler defined for us the concept of a civilization. Toynbee defined the concept of a universal state, or all-powerful government ruling over an entire civilization. But neither was able to refine his analysis to the point of setting forth a pattern of events which our own civilization has followed in the past, and which can be used as a basis for predicting events in the future. More recently, the French writer Amaury de Riencourt, in The Coming Caesars, drew a parallel between Rome and America, sufficiently close to make possible a prediction that if the course of history is not changed, America, like Rome, will come to be ruled by an all-powerful chief executive. In my own forthcoming book, The Last Crossroads, The Historic Position of Western Civilization Today, I undertake to build on the work of the three great historians I have just mentioned, Spengler, Toynbee, de Riencourt, to show specifically and accurately what is in store for Western civilization if it continues to follow, as it has been following, the pattern of its predecessors. Before beginning to explain my analysis and conclusions in detail, I would like to make one point very clear. There is no basis for a belief in historical fatalism or determinism, no matter how often a recurring pattern is found in the rise and fall of civilizations. Men are individuals with rational minds. They are not and never will be automatically bound to repeat the errors and the tragedies of the past. Once enough reasoning men know the true nature and cause of those past errors and tragedies, once they see the full pattern of historic evolution which explains them, they need repeat them no longer. They can set a new course with a happier ending. Let us begin with a comparison of the two civilizations best known to us, our own and our immediate predecessor, the classical civilization of Greece and Rome. Greco-Roman civilization and our own are clearly distinct, separated by the abyss of a dark age, using different languages, professing different religions. Yet both showed a strikingly similar pattern of development. In the Greco-Roman world, we can trace the whole course of rise and fall. In our own civilization, we can trace the rise. And in our own time, we can see the most vivid signs of the trends which, unless changed, will lead ultimately to the fall. Let us make this comparison step by step between Greco-Roman civilization and our own. For those interested in dates, and dates are extremely important if we hope to understand a pattern in history well enough to predict its appearance in the future, the beginnings of Greco-Roman civilization may be put at about 1,000 years before the birth of Christ, and the beginnings of our own about 600 years after Christ's birth. This gives the whole of Greco-Roman civilization a time span of 1,600 years. If our civilization, beginning in 600 AD, should have a lifespan of similar length, we could expect its fall about the year 2200, that is, less than 250 years from now. The first stage in both these civilizations is a dark age. That term dark age has a very real and specific meaning, entirely distinct from the loose term Middle Ages, a span of time in the history of our Western world which included many periods of rapid progress and great achievement. A dark age is a period when cities and even towns have almost vanished, when education is unknown or confined to a few cloistered retreats, when there is little or no circulating money, when there is only the tiniest trickle of trade and scarcely a trace of industry. A dark age is a time of anarchy and savagery, when marauding bands sweep the countryside and there is no refuge from them. A dark age is the origin of feudalism, which begins as a system for protecting the landless by agreement with a landholding baron who has a castle and armed men to defend it. Looking at history, we find such a dark age in Europe from the fall of the Roman Empire in the West to the time of Charlemagne, a period of 300 years. And we also find it in ancient Greece, from shortly after the Trojan Wars to the earliest beginnings of the Greek cities, a period of about 350 years, during which the knowledge of writing itself was lost. That is the first parallel. The next follows in sequence. It is the rise of cities and of trade, cities and trade which are independent of the feudal nobles and gradually supplant them as the standard bearers of the advance of civilization. Cities appear and grow as the gradual accumulation of capital through the feudal system, inefficient as it is, eventually makes possible a rising market demand for trade goods and the necessary investments to supply that demand through trade. This requires enterprising individuals who understand the value and the uses of freedom. These are the sort of individuals who build these rising cities and lead them to prosperity. In our civilization, the greatest achievements of the early city builders and traders were in Italy after 1100 AD. Somewhat later, other cities of the same kind began to appear throughout Western Europe, most of them guaranteed self-government by charter. In ancient Greece, exactly the same sort of development of cities took place, first in the Greek homeland itself, then on other shores of the Mediterranean, after 750 BC. After a prolonged period of flourishing and conflict, these rising cities, in both Greco-Roman civilization and our own, brought forth individual creative geniuses who were responsible for a kind of cultural explosion which set the basic forms and themes of art, literature, and thought for centuries to come. In Greece, this period was the brilliant age of Pericles, centered upon Athens. In our own civilization, it was the Italian Renaissance, centered upon the city of Florence. The climax was reached at about 440 BC in Greece and at about 1480 AD in Renaissance Italy. After this, both in Greece of the Periclean Age and Italy of the Renaissance, The city-states were conquered and swallowed up by larger powers from the outlying areas of the civilization, the nuclei of later nation-states. The growth of the civilization continued. The individual of creative genius and the individual of enterprising ability were both still very much in demand, and different nations bid against one another for the favors of such individuals. Some permitted their citizens more freedom and others less, and those who encouraged individual freedom by limiting government eventually forged to the top. In the Greco-Roman world, the period of contending nation-states preceding and following the conquests of Alexander the Great was known as the Hellenistic Age. In our own civilization, this period includes the early modern history of Europe following the Protestant Reformation. The supremacy of the most free nation was established in the Greco-Roman world when the Republic of Rome won its decisive victory over Carthage in the Second Punic War, ending in 201 BC. The supremacy of the most free nation in early modern Europe was established when Great Britain won its decisive victory over Napoleon at the deservedly famous Battle of Waterloo in 1815. It may be surprising to hear Rome spoken of as the most free nation in the ancient world, when we are accustomed to thinking of Rome of the Caesars and of the later empire. But before it became an empire ruled by Caesars, Rome had been a republic for almost 500 years. In 201 BC, when the Republic of Rome defeated Carthage, Rome had a government of checks and balances that really worked. Oppression and control of the productive individual by the state was almost unknown. The same was true of the government of Great Britain in the 19th century, which made the closest approach to true laissez-faire capitalism known to history. This simply meant that individuals were almost always allowed to do business as they wished, so long as they did not use force against others. The Roman Republic of the 2nd century BC also approached very close to laissez-faire capitalism. Both Great Britain of the 19th century in our own civilization and Rome of the 2nd century BC in classical civilization reaped enormous rewards from their policy of freedom and limited government. Each was the strongest military power in the world of its time, and so was able to act as guardian of international peace. Each held some overseas provinces and colonies, but made no attempt to rule all or most of the civilized nations and peoples of the world. Each deliberately encouraged and protected free trade. As a result of these constructive policies, each experienced a tremendous upsurge in productivity, in standard of living, and in the accumulation of wealth in private hands available for further capital investment. In our own civilization, there was another nation, originally English, which shared in these rewards because it also enjoyed the limited government of checks and balances and the high valuation of individual freedom which made them possible. That nation was, of course, our own United States of America. Throughout the 19th century, America was second to Britain as a power in the world, but was protected by British policy and shared in the benefits of peace and freedom. Then, in this 20th century, America emerged as the leading power and thus took over the role of Britain in our civilization, which was the role of Rome in the ancient Mediterranean world. The result of the Great Age of Peace and Free Trade was to bring about a marked concentration of wealth in individual hands, in the hands of the most competent enterprisers and producers who had done the most to create it. But, tragically, the simple objective justice of allowing enterprisers and producers to keep and use all the earnings of their enterprise and their production, without government regulation or control, was not realized, not in Rome, nor in Britain, nor in America. Instead, the accumulation of capital in private hands became the rallying cry of demagogues who proposed to use the power of the state to seize and redistribute it, allegedly for the benefit of the poor, actually for the benefit of those who control the government. This could not be done without breaking down the whole structure of limitations on government power, the system of checks and balances, the safeguards of individual freedom. That process of breakdown began with the reforms of the Gracchi in Rome in 133 BC. In our civilization, it began with the reforms of the British Liberal government in 1909 and of the so-called Progressive Movement in the United States during the first 15 years of this century. It grew and spread with the advance of socialism in our civilization, and the advance of something very like socialism in the troubled Greco-Roman world shortly before and after 100 BC. The upset of the internal balance of power in the leading nations of both civilizations was followed, in both, by the upset of the external balance of power, the balance among nations. Nations smaller and less strong than the leading power, but highly ambitious, became totalitarian and aggressive. Their rulers launched general war. In the Greco-Roman world, this totalitarian aggressor was a king called Mithridates of Pontus. In our time, he was Adolf Hitler. Mithridates' war, a savage conflict which engulfed the whole of the eastern Mediterranean, finally ended in the total defeat of Mithridates by Rome in 81 BC. Hitler's war, an equally savage conflict which engulfed the whole of Europe, finally ended in the total defeat of Nazi Germany by America and Great Britain in 1945. The parallel here is almost exact. But the real significance of both Mithridates and Hitler lay not in their defeat, but in the fact that both were just a bit premature. Neither Romans nor Americans, in their respective civilizations, were yet ready to accept the kind of one-man rule that these two tyrants represented. But after the Great War was over, the decay of republican institutions continued. More and more rapidly, all real power was being concentrated in the hands of the chief executive. In America, the president. In Rome, three men called triumvirs, and finally in Julius Caesar as dictator, an office provided for in the unwritten constitution of the Roman Republic, though it was supposed to be held only during a supreme military emergency. On this chief executive office, dictator in Rome, president in the United States, and its holder, an awesome concentration of both love and hatred began to be focused in the last days of the Republic. This tensely emotional atmosphere gathered around Julius Caesar in the year 44 BC and around President John F. Kennedy in 1963. The result was assassination. The motives and political affiliations of the assassins in the two cases did not really matter. What was important was the result, and the result of both assassinations in the twilight of the Roman and the American republics was virtually identical. It was a tremendous surge of emotional public support for the leader who had been assassinated, for the family of that leader, and for the office and the power he had held. One of its side effects was to crush within a year or two all major sources of political opposition to the concentration of executive power. We should be clear that these two parallel assassinations were particularly important because of the point in the sequence of events at which they occurred. There are, of course, other historically significant assassinations which do not show this kind of parallel. But each of these two, coming just at the moment when the power of the chief executive of the strongest nation in the world was bursting the last bonds which held it in check, was a true pivot on which the history of an entire civilization turned. In Rome, the successor of Julius Caesar was the man who had stood beside him in power as his chief lieutenant, Mark Antony. But the heir of Julius Caesar by family, and the man who used that family tie eventually to reach supreme power, was young Octavian, Caesar's nephew. Again, following the parallel, in America, we find the successor of the slain John F. Kennedy in the presidential office to be his handpicked former vice president, Lyndon Johnson. While the heirs by family relationship, Senators Robert and Edward Kennedy, are, in the opinion of most political analysts, already aiming at the presidency. When Octavian, Caesar's heir, reached his goal of supreme power in Rome, it was he who dug the grave of the Republic and set up a true empire in its place, a total despotism ruled by the princeps, the first citizen. The outward trappings and symbols of the dead republic were preserved, and for some years there was an official pretense that a republic still existed. But later historians, both classical and modern, were not deceived. They knew that when all effective power was vested in one man, the emperor, a wholly new type of government came into being. A total state in the leading power of a civilization reigns supreme in that civilization. It becomes what Arnold Toynbee has called a universal state. In its machinery are to be found the only safe roads for personal advancement. Individual production and enterprise under a total state exist only to serve that state. They can be and are taxed more and more as the years go by. A total state, by its very nature, makes a total claim on all the resources and all the productivity of its citizens. At first, it does not actually collect on that total claim. In time, as the size of its military and bureaucratic establishment grows irreversibly, it must collect on its full claim, leaving its producers in bankruptcy and despair. The process takes time, but a remarkably similar length of time. The history of many civilizations shows that universal states appear to flourish for about 200 years in nearly every case. After that much time has passed, the growing demands of the growing government exceed the total productive capacity of the enslaved citizens, and the economy collapses. This is what happened in the Roman Empire in the 3rd century A.D. By then, taxes so severe that they drove the leading citizens of nearly every town into bankruptcy and forced some actually to sell their children into slavery were still not sufficient to support the government. Unpaid soldiers rebelled. The combination of public disorder and the dissipation of capital drastically reduced both production and trade to the point where many cities were largely or entirely depopulated. Houses and streets were deserted. The survivors fled to the country. In large areas, money disappeared from circulation because most people simply could no longer afford to possess any. In place of circulating currency, barter returned. There was a drastic decline in population. All these are established facts of the 3rd century A.D. They were the beginning of the end of Greco-Roman civilization. By a series of Herculean efforts, the last Roman emperors, during the final 2 centuries of the empire in the West, were able to reestablish much of the old political authority of the empire, but with shrunken frontiers, a frozen and unproductive society, and a drastic decline in the standard of living. As the army and the government grew weaker, no longer able to sustain itself from the declining production of individuals who had been taxed into poverty, the barbarians on the frontiers, hitherto scorned or ignored, became a rising, looming threat. Eventually, they overran the frontiers and the whole of the Western Roman Empire and all of Europe, from Scotland to the Balkans, plunged into a dark age, out of which our own civilization, much later, emerged.